So I'm Gaurav, I'm a cloud architect at Hotstar, and today we are going to talk about how we scale our application and what is the engineering efforts that went behind how we could like handle a traffic like 25 million during the recent World Cup. So before we start, quick show of hands, like how many of you watched the India-New Zealand game, the semi-finals on Hotstar? Wow, amazing. So we'll start with this graph because most of you will be able to relate with what exactly this is. So this is the actual traffic, like the concurrency pattern that we had on our platform, and as you can see here, this is the toss. So if you can, like, this is the toss. What happens is you get a lot of there is a notification that goes out. And what happens is you get a lot of users at like that particular point. Usually like the matches were at 3 p.m. So at 2:30-ish, you get a small spike of 3 million, 4 million. And then like people come back when the first ball is like, starting. So what happens is the match, this particular match was spread across 2 days because it was rain affected. And as you can see, the New Zealand batting, their peak was around 13.9 million. The sudden dips that you see in between, if you are a cricket follower, those are in IPL those are strategic timeouts. In cricket, those are drinks break, which usually happens at the 16th over and the 32nd over. And during the New Zealand batting, what you can see is most of the time the concurrency was about 10 million. So it is not like one of the event wherein you hit a peak and come back. This graph shows you that like the platform is resilient and is very stable to handle 10 plus million of load for a stretch duration of like multiple hours. And the New Zealand was like doing good and they hit a peak of 13.9 before the rain impacted the match. And then suddenly a lot of viewers went away, but still the match wasn't called off. It was called off like late in the night around 10. And you can see like there were still 4-5 million people on Hotstar, like still waiting for the match to begin and like India to win. So that sentiment was there, and this is something first time we are seeing, like there was nothing on the show, like there was no cricket being played, there was like just commentators or like highlights were being showed, but still 4-5 million people were like stuck to their screen just waiting for match to start. Finally, when the match was like called off, it got postponed to the next day. And what happened was New Zealand still had like 4 or 5 hours left. So the first spike that you see is the sudden surge of traffic for those 4 overs. And the dip is when the Indian team went in to pad up and come back. So you can relate the entire graph with the cricket's inning or journey. What the main thing that I want to highlight is how quickly the traffic goes from like 1 or 1.5 million to almost 15 million. That is the surge that is important. That is like you are talking about adding 1 million users every minute on your platform. And things like your backend, EC2, or like whatever infrastructure you use, it is very difficult to cope with such kind of traffic. Then there was like few wickets falling at regular interval, but then Dhoni stood up and like people almost thought that okay, we'll win this match. There were a lot of positive hopes, and that's where an interesting thing started to happen. So around mid innings, around I think 30-35, when Dhoni was batting really well, we started seeing almost like 1 million users getting added to our platform every minute. Suddenly from 13-14 million, we almost went to 25.3 million. And that is the number at which like Dhoni got out. It's very unfortunate because that day like Hotstar made a global record, but at the same time like because like India is losing, you have those mixed feelings, like you cannot really celebrate when your team is losing. So we had to go through those factors as well. And the other thing that you see is from 25 million there is a sudden drop. What happens is when people stop watching match, you either click a back button or you come to the home page. So you have to understand this from an engineering perspective, or like a if like some of you are like Android or iOS developers, you are coming to the home page. It is not that the traffic has really shifted away from the platform. Now you are making more home page calls. So on a Hotstar homepage, you have mastered, you have those trees, you have personalized content like continue watching, or because you have watched this content, you should watch this. So the recommendation engine, the personalization engine, it really takes a lot of it when things like this happen. Like you have 25 million people watching one content, and suddenly your backend systems take a hit wherein you start getting all the calls. Because when you are watching a video, you are just requesting the playback file or the video file. There is not much of a thing that goes at the API level. But when the traffic shifts from live content to your homepage, at the scale, it's like a huge hit. Prakar already spoke about this, so I'm going to skip this slide. But yeah, I'm going to talk about the point three, which is one day 100 million. So the graph that we saw, 25.3 million was the peak. And that is the first time that we had 100 million unique users on Hotstar platform. So out of those 100 million unique users, 25.3 were like active on the platform at like given instance. So that's the scale. And this is a 2.5x increase in what we had before this. So this year during IPL, we did 18.6 million. But before that, the biggest concurrency we had was during IPL 2018, that was 10.3. So if you look from last year to this year, there has been a 2.5x increase in our concurrency that we can handle. Again, this slide, Prakar spoke about like almost all the things, but I wanted to stress a bit on the 10 Tbps number. This is the bandwidth that we consume when we do live matches. And we were doing upward of 10 terabytes per second when we were streaming to 25 million users. To give more insight into this number, this is almost 70-75% of India's internet. So it's like really huge. And if things like your infrastructure, things like your application, you can scale up, but there is a limit to how much you can scale your network delivery, because these are like fiber optic cables, hard lines, or like last mile latency that we are talking about. So there is a limited set of internet infrastructure that is available in India as of today, and we almost use 70% of that. And why is 25.3 million a big number? So this again will give some perspective into that. So before we creating a record last year of 10.3, the global concurrency record was like with YouTube. There was a supersonic space jump, Red Bull event, which was done I think in Australia. Around 8 million people were watching that event. That happened in 2012. From 2012 to 2018, there was no big event. Like there were so many significant events, like there was Super Bowl, there was Royal Wedding, then there was Donald Trump inauguration, which was again around 4 million. But no one could break that record until like IPL 2018 happened. And if you see from IPL onwards, like last year, the concurrency is just going up and up. So that's like, that is why, like if you compare to the nearest competitor, if you compare to the nearest competitor, it's like almost 3x of what they usually do. So how do we prepare the platform to take so much hit, and how the services are able to handle that much load or take that much beating when we have a live event? So we have something called as Project Hulk. This is the load generation, or you can say the load testing project that we have in-house. These are few of the numbers. We use C5 and NX-Large machine. Each of those instances has 36 CPUs and around 72 GB of RAM. We use upward of 3000 such machines to just generate the load. So like 100K CPUs, 216 terabytes of RAM. This is the hardware that goes behind running those load tests. And So what used to happen is earlier, when we used to do a load testing for Hotstar, we also used to impact other customers because the network is shared in a public cloud. The network is shared among all the people. And when it comes to your CDN partners, even they have the same connectivity or same edge locations that power all the customers. So we noticed that when we do load testing of such scale, it used to impact other users as well or other customers as well. So what we did is we geo-distributed our load. So right now our load generation, whenever we do this, is spread across 8 different regions. In APAC, in Middle East, we use US regions, and even in like Ireland, London. So it is spread across the globe so that a single region is not overwhelmed and there is no impact to other customers or the public cloud network. And that's the bandwidth that is that goes out per second. So we do a 200 Gbps of network out during our load test. And this project is capable of like mimicking the entire user journey. So what happens is when you launch an app, there are a bunch of API calls that happen, which checks whether you are logged in, whether you have a valid payment, whether you have a subscription, or whether you are entitled to watch a particular content. So all these API calls in an orderly fashion, how they are called when the user interacts with that is scripted, and that entire user journey is something that we test by variable input. So we have scripts and we have tools that can mimic the entire match. So the graph that we saw on the first page, if I have to replay that entire traffic pattern, we have those capabilities wherein I can say, okay, like India-New Zealand semifinal, this was the traffic pattern, this was the spike. It will be able to like load test all those APIs, whatever is like the relevant call. Because you have to think it in this way that, okay, 25 million is the people, but are all of those 25 million people making an API call to app A, app B? So there is a variation in those counts. Then we also do a lot of chaos engineering just to make sure that the platform is resilient and is able to handle certain failures without end users coming to know about it, or like it's a graceful degradation, which I'll talk more about in the end. This is a very basic view of what happens during load generation. So those C5-9X large machine are like launched into multiple regions, goes via internet to CDN, eventually it hits the application, your ELB or ALB, and you have the application sitting behind it. And this all happens through the 8 regions that we discussed about. And the main motive of this is to find whether a particular application has any bottlenecks, any limits which have been undiscovered. What happens is at a lower scale, if you just do a normal load testing, most of the issues are not discovered. There are certain issues which only crops up once you cross 10 million or 15 million boundary. So how does the scalings look like? So this is again in the EC2 world. We have a growth rate of 1 million per minute, and the reaction time is almost like less than 90 seconds. You have a live match going on. If you are like scaled up to a 10 million ladder or something like that, suddenly a surge of traffic comes, let's say 5 more million users comes in the next 5 minutes. The time it takes to scale up, because you're talking about EC2 boot up time, your application health checks to pass, the EC2 to register healthy under a load balancer, takes certain amount of time. It is not like you can do that in less than 30 seconds. So to account those time, we have to keep some buffer and scale up in advance. Also what happens is, if there are interesting moments in match wherein, let's say, some bowler has taken a hat trick, or Dhoni or Virat Kohli is hitting 3 sixes. So a marketing team sends a lot of push notifications to engage users or bring more users to the platform. And what happens is, this notification goes to a large user base. We are talking about 150, 2 million, 200 million users. And even if we convert, or we are able to convert like 1% or 2% of that number, we are talking about 4 to 6 million people adding within a fraction of minutes. So why we don't use the traditional autoscaling, and like Prakar was talking about how we build the automation that scales up the platform based on either request or the ladder that we desired. These are few of the factors why we went away from the traditional autoscaling that the cloud provider or your native ASG or ELB has to offer. So you get a lot of insufficient capacity errors when you operate at scale. Anyone here who has seen like they requested any instance type and it failed because the capacity was not there. So at scale, you cannot wait for this error because live match is going on. If I requested 10 servers, I need that. If I don't get it, my customers will get impacted. The second thing is, this is before EC2 fleet came into picture. A single autoscaling group can only support one instance type. What if that particular instance type is out of capacity in one AZ or one region? Then you cannot scale because in real time you cannot go like have a new launch configuration, have a new autoscaling group, change the configuration in the load balancer, shift traffic. That is simply not possible when you have a live match going on. So another challenge is step size of autoscaling group. So the way autoscaling group works is when you raise the the capacity from 10 to 100, what it does is it launches at a step size of 10. So at every 30 seconds it will try to launch 10 servers, but that is very slow for us. We are talking about like asking AWS or cloud provider to give us like 400, 500 servers at every ladder. So this approach is very slow because if it takes 30 seconds or something for just 10 servers, imagine scaling for 500 servers. So even if you increase those limits, what happens is you actually put a lot of load onto the API that are working in the background. So what happens is when you request 100 or 200 servers, there are a lot of get API calls like describe tags, describe instances, which goes on in background. If one of them fails, and if you are reading some values from your EC2 tag, your server or the application will not become healthy and it just gets stuck in the loop. And the last one is interesting. All of us at Hotstar like are fans of Game of Thrones, so this is a reference to that, the game of availability zone. So what really happens is let's consider you have three ACs, 1A, 1B, 1C. If you don't have capacity in one of them, your autoscaling group will try to launch servers in the other two, the remaining two ACs. But what happens is this slowdowns your scaling process because the autoscaling group, the algorithm or whatever is there behind, it tries to launch it in the AZ which doesn't have capacity. So it will try in 1A, successful, 1B, successful. Here it is a failure in 1C, but it will keep trying launching that server in 1C in the loop. If it doesn't find capacity, it will fall back to 1A, 1B. What happens is your infra is queued, like you have like more instances in 1A, 1B than 1C. And that what happens is it also adds a lot of exponential backoff and retry. So we have seen like, because of a single AZ not having capacity, our autoscaling group, like the launch time increased to 25 minutes because of the exponential backoff that it adds after every failure, it grows from 30 seconds to 1 minute to 5 minutes, 10 minutes. So that is how the retry period become like keeps on increasing. So that is something we cannot have during a live match. Those were the like few of the reasons why we don't rely on traditional autoscaling, and we built our own autoscaling thing which scales up the infrastructure at a fixed ladder based on the traffic that is currently like each application is currently serving, that is like request based or the concurrency that is there on the platform. This is what we do before the match for scaling for high concurrency event. Pre-warm the infra before match, proactive scale ups, again that is completely automated. We use spot instances, spot fleet especially. What this does is it gives you an option to like choose multiple instance types. So you are not limited by a single instance type. In spot fleet, you can specify 50 different instance types. You can like play around with the instance type of your choice. spread it across multiple AGs. So you have diversification of the compute capacity that you require. And this was again before the EC2 fleet came into picture. Since one ASG cannot have more than one instance type, we always had a backup ASG just in case we are not able to scale, let's say C4X, we will have another ASG which has C42X. If this is not able to scale up, there is a SNS notification that is triggered, there is a lambda function which will automatically scale the second ASG. So those kind of automation we had built in. Now talking about chaos engineering, what are the things that can cause an actual chaos at Hotstar, like during a live match? So these are few of the things. Push notification I already spoke about. Increased latency. So this has a lot of like downstream effect. If any of the API, let's say the response time increases by 20 or 30 milliseconds, there is a lot of impact to the downstream services. Let's say my content platform has an API which my recommendation or personalization engine is using. If there is a 30 ms increase here, there can be a 200 ms increase here because it relies on that API to serve to the end user. And the interesting part about personalization engine and all these things are these APIs cannot be cached because each user has its own different taste and personalization content that he watches. So your watch history or your recommendation will be different than what my recommendations are. So these things cannot be cached. These are going to the back end. So any increase in latency is simply like not acceptable. Delayed scale up we also spoke about with the reference to the EC2. The scale up when it needs to happen. You cannot like say okay there is no capacity or due to X issue I'll scale up after 5 minutes. The match is not going to wait for you. Tsunami traffic is the one that we saw in the first graph. The sudden growth and increase of traffic and the sudden drop. This is something that can kill the platform or take the entire backend down, because you are talking about choke at any level, like a DB level or your caches or anything. Also, another thing that I missed mentioning is, so this year, while preparing for this game days and everything, what we also did is we came up with an internal project wherein now we know how much is the capacity, like the rated capacity each application can support, and what is the breaking point of each system. So with chaos engineering and load testing of this kind, what like visibility that we get or the insight that we have for each application is how much RPS it can support and what is the breaking point. When that breaking point is about to like reach or the application is near that, we apply some gimmicks to just like give them a breathing room so that the services are not impacted. And bandwidth constraints is related to that 10 terabytes number which I was earlier talking about. So you can scale up your EC2, you can increase your compute nodes from let's say 500 to 5000. But bandwidth and all is something that is not in your hand, because here we are talking about the physical internet like delivery infrastructure of the India. You have like multiple big players in the industry, and whatever is the infrastructure that they have set up, like for example Jio has now plans to come up with 5G or something. So a provider like Hotstar or anyone in the industry is going to utilize those bandwidth, those pipes of internet delivery. If the requirement, like our requirement is bigger than that, you simply cannot like handle more users. At that rate, you then need to look at compression and other things that can like reduce the video bandwidth that each user consume, so that you can accommodate more users in the same pipe. And network CDN failures are again very scary. What happens is if one of your CDN partners, edge or pop location, has some issues, and let's say you are serving 10 million users, the users that were being served from a particular edge location or pop location, they will have to retry. All their requests comes to origin, and this is actually bad, because when you gradually scale up, there is, because once the content is cached, it doesn't come to origin unless like it has refreshed or something. But if there is a edge location or a pop location failure, all the users that were like being served from that edge will now fall back to the origin. So at a 10 million scale, if I say like even 5% of those calls come to us, that means the APIs that were earlier rated or designed to handle load in a gradual pattern, they just have a flood of requests like all at once. So that is also something that we have to take into consideration. So the things that we discover from these kind of exercise or the game days that we do is basically find out what are the bottleneck, what are the choke points. Like I said, not all issues you can discover by running a normal load test of like 10 million, 10 users or 100 users. Some patterns only are discovered, or like the cascading effect of a single latency increase in one application is only discovered at a scale. So like while we achieved a global record of like 25.3 million, the load testing that we did to make our platform resilient was for 50 million. So even if like the traffic would have been like 45, 48 million, we would still be able to handle that kind of load. It was unfortunate that like Dhoni got out and India lost on that day. Otherwise, we were like prepared to handle even more load without like user seeing any issues on that particular day. So breaking point of each system, this is a project that I talked about earlier, wherein you have information and in what each application is capable of handling and what are the breaking points. So death wave is that sudden spike, the sudden drop. So that is why I showed the graph in the start of the talk, so that you guys can relate what it means to a live cricket match. And to overcome the things that cannot be fine-tuned and like optimized with application tuning or stuff like that is panic mode. So what we do is, if we know that okay, API X cannot handle more than 10 million users, we go into a graceful degradation mode, wherein panic mode is basically you have all your critical services up, you shut down everything else, thereby making room or the bandwidth for your key services. So key services for us is video delivery, ads, subscription. If there is a feature like social, chat, emojis that you send during the match, those are not that important when you talk about video delivery. So when you have 25.3 million users on a platform, you know everyone is watching match. So non-match services like recommendation, personalization can be turned off, because you know that okay, 99% of your user base is just watching match. So by turning off these services, I can reduce the load on my backend. I can reduce the load on the network pipe that is there, so that there is more room for video, there is more room for API calls that are important to users and the application. So this is all those things. Like, we degrade gracefully, even if like let me give you an example. Like, let's say our login services has some issues during live match, it automatically goes into a panic mode, wherein users are not even shown the login screen. It won't ask you for username password, because we know that okay, a genuine user has come, our system has a problem, we won't show the login screen. We'll just let him bypass the login system and watch the match or the content he wants to watch. Because if let's say you have RDS or anything in the background which has issues, troubleshooting that issue or fixing that problem can take time, and you don't really want to impact the user in that moment of the game. So graceful degradation and panic mode is something that we do a lot. So we have a like a runbook kind of stuff, wherein at every 5 million interval we take off certain services which don't add value to my customers or the users watching the game, thereby creating more room or space for the actual stuff which is really important. here are the key takeaways. Prepare for failure, know what your systems are like capable of, and what are the breaking limits of that. Thereby you can take decisions like turning off the services or improving or optimizing those things. User journey, understanding of that is very important. Like I said, we know what the entire user journey is. The moment you open an app, what X number of API calls you will make. If you click the watch page, what actions happen and how much API calls will come to backend, how much will be served through cache. So understanding of that pattern really helps you to design your system, make your application or platform more resilient. And it is okay to degrade gracefully because you don't want to show an error, or like you don't want to let the end user know that okay, there is a burning issue at your end. Let's say the same example, my login system is down because of some DB CPU issue or the disk is full. It is better to allow that user to watch the content, bypass the login, then showing him a error screen saying that okay, like the login system is temporarily down, which is a bad user experience. So think from that perspective. Cool, that's all I had for today.
Thanks, Gaurav. Do we have any questions?
Hey, Gaurav, thanks for the session. It's pretty cool. Ninad here.
Hey, hi.
I have two questions which are sort of related to scaling issues that you start seeing at the work that Hotstar does. You've talked about scaling your application, your compute capacity, but have you ever run into issues with the load balancers themselves, whether you're talking of ELBs, network load balancers? How did you work around that? So, is one thing I would like to know. The second is, all of these things that keep monitoring and are doing like your warming up of your instances, they're all going to consume API calls. AWS API calls, and there are per account, per service API limits.
There are regional limits, there are account limits.
Yep, thanks. That's what I would love to hear.
Cool. So addressing the first questions about the load balancers, though load balancer are like called elastic load balancer, they have their own periodic limits that they can scale up to. And all our applications breach that daily. So all our load balancers are sharded. That means the maximum level that a load balancer can scale up to or be pre-warmed to, that has been reached. And then we have to shard this load balancers into like in multiples of 3 or 5. So we use like 5 or more load balancers, all at their peak capacity. Then the traffic is distributed through a weighted routing or stuff like that. So that is how you scale, because though it is like elastic, not in the reality. About the second thing, which was API calls, right? So there are a number of limits. Like even if I talk about the get API describe calls of all the services, the other issues that we run into is the CloudWatch API throttling, which Prakar also mentioned, like API throttling is a big issue. So we work with AWS to see what is the best that can be done. They increase our limits to best possible level which the service team agrees to. But in the end, if there are still there are throttling, we have to build our own solutions along that. So in reality, it always doesn't work. I'll say that we still have some nuances around API throttling, which is a reality. That is why even like the security tools that we run, we always test that in an environment wherein we can log how much API calls they will consume. Because even if you have a normal, let's say a security scanner which sees what all users don't have MFA, each of them is gonna consume an API call. And we don't want a utility or any other system consuming even small portion of the API call limit that we have, which is not for the user or which will impact my production systems. So that is a reality. But then that leads to a lot of, it's a different conversation, because now you're dealing with two different account IDs, how you scale, and it becomes more complex.
Hi, Gaurav.
Hi.
This is Himanshu. So my question was, when you have a, such a critical window, right, and you correctly point out you have dependencies on other folks also,
yes.
like other people in the stack, like
yeah.
a CDN and AWS. So do you guys have like a, do you guys figured a process around a game plan that you had all the scenarios run through them, there are
yeah.
people on support on all of them?
That's a all the round year activity that we like closely work with our partners to ensure that whatever is the requirement that we need are there in place. But sometimes it's simply not possible for them to like, because no one in the world is doing stuff at this scale, right, when it comes to video streaming. So for them also it sometimes it's difficult, but we work together to bridge that gap and whatever best is possible. But yeah, there are issues that are still there. Yep.
Sorry.
One question is related to the bandwidth that you talked about. You said you were utilizing 70% of India's bandwidth.
Yeah.
And you said you were doing 25 million users.
Yeah.
Right. I do not like think that
this
that would have
video.
Worked for 50
yeah.
million users, because
mm.
you said you could scale your microservices for 50 million
yeah.
users, but the bandwidth in India would have choked at that point.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right.
So we are also limited by the
right.
partners that we work with.
Right.
So I talk about compression and all
right.
those stuff.
But
so
they would help
way,
only to a limited level, right?
Yeah.
Your video,
so,
video content is not compressionable to a very huge
mm-hmm.
extent.
So in that case, what we do is to accommodate more users. Let's say people are watching content that HD. You reduce that quality so that you can accommodate more users.
Graceful degradation
in the
again.
Same pool of resources that you have.
Right. Second question is microservices and services you can scale.
Yeah.
What about databases?
So they are already provisioned for the peak.
Okay. Fair.
Because those are not like real time things that
right.
you can scale. So that is something that our game days give us a number that okay, for so many users, this is the type of instance that, that you should have. And that is provisioned throughout the tournament. So we have like two sets of infra, one for like sports season, non-sports season. So you fall back after the IPL World Cup is over.
I had a related question. You mentioned most of the infra is AWS specific.
Yeah.
So is there any other player in the country, let's say talking about IPL,
mm-hmm.
who can you can partner with, who can handle this kind of load?
Not sure. Not sure. Not authorized to comment on that. But yeah, off the record, today's reality, even if like 2-3 partners come together, work together, still it's gonna be a tough thing for us.
Yeah. Because I'm not sure if there's any from the top three
mm-hmm.
clouds, and if anyone else has that big presence apart
yeah.
from AWS. And the second question is related to it, which is coming at 70% of India's bandwidth, is there so AWS works like an off the shelf, you
mm-hmm.
have an account, but do you do any other special planning when you are targeting 70% of country's bandwidth? Do you have to
so this is the video bandwidth, this
right.
is not just AWS, this is like the CDN partner Akamai and other people, but yeah, like I said, we work with them around the year. It's not that you just go 2 weeks before IPL and talk to them, okay, I need this much capacity. So IPL 2020 is like far away, but we have already give them our plans, like what are the things that we are looking for, and that is a year-round activity that we have
right.
to work on.
Yeah. Thanks.